joining us today for his take on the markets, Miguel Agarao of PhilEquity. Miguel, thank you so much for joining us finally.
Good morning, Mimi. I still haven't seen you in person in the studio.
I know, over a year. Okay, hopefully this pandemic is over and we're going to, you know, meet up again at the Philippine Stock Exchange. But before that, let's talk about the outlook. I mean, yesterday we were talking and you said this market is simply not exciting. One viewer, in fact, yesterday asked on Twitter, is there a risk of exhaustion if this market doesn't move up soon? Does the market feel exhausted to you, Miguel? I mean, we've been bouncing around a range, but really going nowhere.
Okay. Good morning, Mimi. Good morning, everyone. I wouldn't say that the market is exhausted. I think the better word would be worried, especially because, remember, we had 2 weeks of ECQ. We're now with MECQ. And really top of mind of everyone is COVID, especially the recent resurgence where it's getting, you know, quite closer to home already. For many people. So the market is really waiting for that catalyst, which will get us out of this rut, which is, you know, repeating resurgences of the COVID-19. Then that's really mass vaccination. So the market is waiting for that, for evidence of vaccinations picking up in a big way, such that we hit a point where a very large portion of our population is vaccinated, and therefore the chance of a resurgence drops significantly. So I say the word is worried.
Mm-hmm. And by worried, do you expect this market to be trading within this range, or is there some more leg to go down?
Okay, if you're looking at it on a longer term basis, I think with the mass vaccination going to happen, it's just a function of which month it happens and maybe the pace at which it occurs. You know, long term, especially going into national elections next year, the market should do well. Your question is what happens in the short term, which is the next 3 months or next 6 months or so. Also, that's a bit less certain. And I think that the market probably just moves sideways in the interim. Then you may see some divergence once the 1Q earnings come out. Some companies may do better than others relative to on the basis of year-on-year trends.
Okay, well, let's take a look at the long term. Walk us through the key themes that you expect over the next 6 to 12 months down the line. What investments do you see leveraged into, say, government policy or the vaccination program or the election coming up and possible changes in policy again?
Okay, unlike the U.S., we don't have a bazillion sector here like tech, industry. You know, our country is purely a reopening play. I mean, nearly practically our entire index is cyclical. So, which is why when tech and defensives did well last year, our market didn't do so well until maybe October, November, because we're being bundled with the reopening play. So now that we're getting closer to, you know, some sort of normalcy or, you know, farther past the start of the pandemic, of course, reopening plays are life is getting breathed into them, and which is why our market has started moving higher. However, resurgences are really putting a cap on that. So in terms of reopening, you have to remember that not all reopening plays are made equal. Some of them will hit 2019 earnings this year. Some of them will hit pre-COVID earnings by next year. Some will take until 2023. So thematically, you want to look at those companies which A, will recover faster, and B, whose earnings will go back to, whose balance sheets are stronger than, say, the companies which are having more trouble. So balance sheet would be one factor that will differentiate. I mean, finally, you want to be in companies that will still be existing many years from now. Otherwise, you need that going concern assumption. Mm-hmm. So it's really purely the opening, just picking the best horse.
It seems like you're going for the blue chips, Miguel, and not the speculative second, third liners.
Well, as a fund, you really can't put a lot into those names. You really be mostly in the blue chips, especially in funds of larger size like ours. There is space for non-index names, and some of those have done stellarly well. They are part of our funds, but I say largely, of course, we're still mostly in blue chips.
Okay, just a quick update. The PSE index has started trade. 4 minutes into trading, we're down by a third of 1%, 21.6519. So let's go over some interesting corporate stories that we have from yesterday after trade until this morning. The Philippine government lifting moratorium on new mining contracts. Is this the good news that the mining sector has been waiting for, or is it too late?
Well, the mining sector has been like half dead for a while now. So, you know, of course, all the mining companies will cheer this. And one interesting thing which should be given emphasis is that the reason this lifting of the moratorium was held up was because of EO 79 on the, you know, making a more equitable tax rate for mining companies. But in the recently passed creatory of the doubling of royalties, the argument that moving it from 2% to 4% already counts as creating a more equitable tax rate, and such that, okay, since you complied with that, we will lift the moratorium. It's easy to collect. It's practically top line collection right there. So that's good for the mining sector, especially for those projects which were supposed to be launched like 5-6 years ago, and then, you know, they eventually got mothballed. So with metal prices where they are now, with our economy having a hard time right now, a new revenue stream would be very good. Because if you remember, like maybe 8, 9, 10 years ago, mining was a more significant portion of our GDP than it is now.
Okay, and how about this one? Video leasing and finance posting 283 million pesos in profit for 2020. That's actually flat. Last year, there was a bit of a restructuring that happened with video leasing and finance and BDO. Yeah. So how do you make sense of this sort of earnings report from video leasing and finance?
Okay, it's actually holding up, I guess. It's still holding up well. If you look at BDO's earnings, the provisions, they were still doing okay also, except I expect this part of the business to recover faster versus what you saw in 4Q, because if you look at loans in the past months, the loan growth actually negative growth already. Mm-hmm. So this one might actually do a little bit better as businesses reopen and leasing picks up. But this is leasing and leaseback businesses.
Mm-hmm. And so while we're in the topic of banks, Citibank is shutting down its retail banking operations in 13 countries, including the Philippines. What does that say? I mean, I know it's part of a global strategy. They're also closing down their franchises in China, India, supposedly big markets. But does that say anything about the consumer banking here in the Philippines, retail banking here in the Philippines?
I don't think it's a sign that there's a problem with retail banking. I don't know what's going on in Citi exactly, but to me it sounds like two things. Number one, because of COVID, face-to-face banking is not something that, you know, you really want to emphasize now, which leads me to the second point, is scale. If you don't have enough scale, it might not be profitable to have a, to use your banking license here. So I don't know what exactly the economics are, but you can imagine a lot of them are cost-cutting.
Okay, and speaking of finance, here is one about a fintech, ABS-CBN. Greenergy Holdings of Tony Chu and iBuyit are extending the due diligence period for Tony Chu's purchase of a majority stake in UPay Technologies. This is, of course, the fintech of ABS-CBN. They're extending it by 30 days to May 15, and they're citing the reimposed ECQ. Are you betting big on fintech? Is fintech the way to go?
I think fintech will have a growing share of the pie and will be an emerging industry, as you already saw. It's already been doing well in the past years, and what COVID-19 did was basically accelerate that trend. Mm-hmm. So a lot of companies, like even those of Tony Chu included, want to get into this space. So mm-hmm. I think iBuyit is his partner there. So they're looking at ABS-CBN's license, although I think this transaction is not so big, like, I don't know, 50 million pesos or something.
It's relatively small, but
you know, it shows you that there is interest in this space. And you know, on a listed basis, there are no companies that, you know, have a significant, that you can say, when I buy this, I buy fintech. Like,
PhilEquity
Fund and stuff like that, right?
But Abacor recently also had this deal with SquidPay, which is also into digital banking.
Yes, but I don't think that's fully injected already, right? Mm-hmm. I think they're in the process.
Yeah. Yes, still in the process. Okay, interesting foreign story. Data from Refinitiv showing that global mergers and acquisitions hit $1.3 trillion during the first quarter of this year. That is, wow, a 94% jump year on year, the strongest opening period since records began in 1980. And this is the third quarter in a row that global deal making has come above $1 trillion mark. Miguel, we didn't get a lot of that deal, of those deals, right? I mean, how's deal making here in the Philippines? I know that you hear a lot about these things, possibly involved in some of them, but how are you seeing the deals being made? M&As? I mean, this is supposed to be the perfect time for M&As, right?
It's the perfect time for M&As if you're a company with cash, right?
So, do we have companies with cash?
Well, there are companies with cash, but you can imagine because of the exposure of our economy. I mean, as I told you, we're really mostly the opening play cyclical economy, even on a stock market basis. When Bayanihan 2 rolled over this year, there will be companies whose balance sheets have a problem. And this will be your primary target for those companies who are able to save their balance sheets or are more cash rich. But you know, I wouldn't say by and large everyone's having an easy time, but there will be a lot of targets. The question is, are there how many companies are there enough ammunition willing to catch these bargains? So the M&A will likely be more active abroad. Here, it's going to pick up for sure. I don't know if at that pace. I mean, our market has seen like how many consecutive months and nearly years of foreign outflows. So, yeah. You know, it's, but you know, we'll get the slice of that pie at least, I think.
Miguel, are you hearing anything from your circles? Any interesting companies up for sale soon?
I don't want the SEC to be on my tail, okay? So assuming I hear something,
Okay. Okay, we've come to them. Okay, fine. Let's go to the blind item now, the most exciting part of the conversation. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. I know that you like this. Don't tell us what it is, but just describe. We'll leave it to our viewers to guess. So what do you have for us this morning?
Okay, this is a blue chip. This is a property name. It's a member of the PSEi. This has actually underperformed the index in the past few months, even though it's a very high quality name. The owners actually started buying just 2 days ago. They bought significant chunks of this stock. This will probably do well in the coming years once the economy reopens. Relatively strong balance sheet, one of the biggest index heavyweights. So I think this is a stock over the long term that if you want to invest in the Philippines, you have to own this stock.
What sort of upside in share price are you seeing for this stock in the next 6 to 12 months?
Well, if you look at this stock right now, it's practically back to where it was in 2017, 2016. So this one easily on a conservative basis, not even fair value, you can see this go up a little over 20% over 12 months, and that's conservatively. If the economy reopens fast and you have mass vaccination, you can do a lot better than that.
Okay, we're just going to have to guess if they want to take advantage of that at least 20% upside. Miguel, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a great weekend ahead.
Thank you, Mimi. Stay safe. Get
Stay
vaccinated
safe.
When it's our turn.
Thank you. We'll see you soon.